In this video, we will discuss the relative polarity of bonds and characterize bonds as nonpolar covalent bonds, polar covalent bonds, and ionic bonds. There is a common misconception that bonds are either all covalent or all ionic. In actuality, there is a continuum from covalent bonds, a bond that shares electrons, to ionic bonding, transfer of electrons from one atom to another. The continuum between covalent and ionic is based on the properties of the elements. One of these properties is electronegativity, which will help us determine whether a bond is nonpolar covalent, polar covalent, or ionic. Let's define these three types of bonds. A nonpolar covalent bond is a bond in which the bonding electrons are shared equally between two atoms, resulting in no charges or partial charges on the atoms in the bond. A polar covalent bond is a bond in which the bonding electrons are shared unequally between the two atoms, resulting in partial charges on the atoms. An ionic bond is a bond in which there is a complete transfer of one or more valence electrons from one atom to another, resulting in full charges on the resulting ions. To determine whether something is nonpolar covalent, polar covalent, or ionic bonding, we will consider the electronegativity of the atoms in the bond. Electronegativity defined as the relative ability of an atom to attract electrons to itself in a chemical compound. Elements with high electronegativities tend to have higher electron densities in chemical compounds and are found in the upper right corner of the periodic table. Fluorine is considered the most electronegative atom. Let's look at a few examples. Consider the diatomic molecule chlorine. In this case, we're dealing with a bond between two atoms of the same element. In this case, we would expect it to be fully nonpolar since we were dealing with the same electronegativity for the element in the bond. Therefore, the bond between the chlorines would be considered a nonpolar covalent bond. Now let's consider hydrogen chloride, HCl. In this case, we see that hydrogen is on the far left of the periodic table, and chlorine is on the far right of the periodic table. The molecule still contains a covalent bond, but there is a large electronegativity difference between the elements. This large electronegativity difference causes there to be nonpolar covalent bond, or unequal sharing of electron density in the bond. The chlorine in this case has a high electronegativity and attracts more electron density to itself. This will result in a partial negative charge on the chlorine atom. The hydrogen has a lower electronegativity. The hydrogen gives up electron density to the chlorine, resulting in a partial positive charge. Therefore, the bond between the hydrogen and the chlorine would be a polar covalent bond. Let us consider sodium chloride for the third example. In this case, the sodium has a very low electronegativity, an electronegativity value of 0.9 on most electronegativity charge. The sodium atom would give up an electron to become a sodium ion. The chlorine has a high electronegative value of 3.0 and would gain an electron from the sodium to become a chlorine anion. Therefore, bonding in sodium chloride is considered an ionic bond. Now notice that in this example, I use the electronegativity values of the elements that are often provided in text to determine the bonding nature between the two elements. The difference between the electronegativity values for elements in a bond can be used to determine whether the bond is nonpolar, polar, or ionic. As a general rule, a bond between two elements that has electronegativity difference of 0.5 or less is generally considered a nonpolar covalent bond. Whereas, a bond between elements with an electronegativity difference in the range of 0.5 to 2 is generally considered a polar covalent bond. A bond between elements with an electronegativity difference of 2.0 or more is generally considered ionic. It is important to understand that this is a general rule to determine the nonpolar covalent, polar covalent, and ionic bonding nature. Let's consider three more examples. The CH bond in methane, the OH bond in water, and the sodium-oxygen attraction in sodium hydroxide. For the CH bond in methane, we consider this a nonpolar covalent bond since the electronegativity difference between the carbon and the hydrogen is low. The carbon has an electronegativity of 2.5, and the hydrogen has an electronegativity of 2.1. The 0.4 difference in electronegativity is less than 0.5, and therefore the bond would be considered a nonpolar covalent bond. For the OH bond in water, the electronegativity difference between the oxygen's electronegativity of 3.5 and the hydrogen's electronegativity of 2.1 is larger than 0.5 and less than 2. Therefore, the OH bond would be considered a polar bond, resulting in a partial negative on the oxygen and a partial positive on hydrogen. For the sodium and oxygen in sodium hydroxide, there is a substantial difference between the sodium's electronegativity of 0.9 and the oxygen's electronegativity of 3.5. In this case, the sodium atom would give up its valence electron to become a sodium cation, and the oxygen atom would gain an electron to become an anion, the hydroxide anion. Therefore, the electrostatic attraction between the positively charged sodium and the negatively charged oxygen would be considered an anionic bond. We can use the electronegativity differences to determine the characteristics of bonds, either nonpolar covalent, polar covalent, or ionic bonds.